Hello.
How are you?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks, lovely. Looking very glamorous.
It's all smoke
Oh, I love that. Oh, how's lockdown been treating you?
and mirrors. I think busier than ever. In fact, I'd be glad of a day off.
Oh, bless you. I think that's the thing. Everyone's been so, I think, either one or the other. I think some people have been like rushed off their feet. They're obviously working in the services and the police and hospitals and accountants. And then obviously a lot of singers and dancers and self-employed people are just, at a wit's end. But have you got wine?
No, it's alcohol-free gin with pink tonic.
Nice. Well, normally,
I
every time I do these, I always have a little lovely. You've even got the berries. Clearly, no. Normally, time I do this, I always have like an alcoholic beverage, being it Friday night. But now I'm back to teaching on Saturday mornings, with like kids. So yeah, I need to be up and focused and fresh.
Exactly. Well done.
So, obviously, with doing all these, I've been chatting to loads of different people, and I never realised. Don't I say some of this might not be true? Were you born in Coventry?
Yeah.
Ah, bro, because I'm originally from Leicester, which isn't too far.
It's not.
Used to go to Coventry quite a bit. Just finding out about, like, before Solid Harmony, what did you do before, like that, your training and stuff? Did you go the performing arts route, or did you? Was it kind of like potluck seeing an audition? What was your kind of history of it?
Well, I started with a thing called performance when I was about six, ballet
Yeah.
lessons from five, singing
Nice.
lessons from about eight. Excuse me one sec. Started joining my first band at 11,
Yeah.
so that was working sort of full time and just trained classically from a
Yeah.
really young age.
Yeah.
And
Wow.
then couldn't wait to turn professional at 16, 17.
Would you say that it all like contributed? Was there a part? I know obviously a lot of people that are in like performing arts in the industry, a lot of singers stick to singing, and then people are surprised when they say, "Oh, I used to do dance lessons as well," or a lot of dancers try singing. Was it like half and half? You liked them both as much, or was it?
No, I couldn't dance at all. I was absolutely petrified. I was rubbish. I was really rubbish. In fact, our manager used to, in Sonna, she used to watch us and really watch me because I knew I could sing, but the whole dance thing used to drive me mad and I was scared to death. So I'd never really been nervous about the singing thing, but oh my God, I'm going to forget where I'm going.
Turn
I'm
the
not
wrong
very
way.
good.
Well, I've got to say, like, from watching what's really nice, once we get to it a little bit, but I saw a clip of you. It was like when I think it was a, I don't know if it was a reunion show or something. And normally, when you get, people coming back together again to do something, they sing their classic songs. But you danced and you're in like a full on dress doing the. And I was like, hats off to you. Is that routine, embedded?
I'll be 99, I'll still be able to do it in my sleep. I don't think I'll ever get away from that.
Oh, so the thing is, a lot of people don't realize as well, when you're a singer, having to learn how to sing and dance at the same time as well, with like breath control. So I suppose your classical training came in handy.
Yeah, but I was really naughty in my 20s. Really naughty, because I used to smoke. I know, I can't believe it. So not only were you singing and dancing, but I was also smoking, which is really bad. I can't believe I did it. But yeah, so I didn't help myself, to be honest. I was a bit stupid. But when you're in your 20s, everyone's a bit stupid, aren't they?
Everyone makes mistakes, yeah. I think
Yeah.
a lot of things, I'm always surprised when I've like met some like different people and I've seen them like in the matinee or after the show go and have a cheeky cigarette, and I'm like, what do you think? You're not supposed to, it's the big no-no. So you're how did one time I'm always interested, like, how did Solid. How did you go from being, you know, the singer and, you know, doing the, you said you were in a group before, getting into Solid Harmony? It was an audition? Because obviously it was, there was two of you were from the UK. One was, Becky was Welsh, wasn't she? And then one from the US.
Well,
how did that happen?
So basically, I think you get to know a lot of people like through word of mouth. So you'll be in a band here and then you'll meet this girl. And a lot of it was through word of mouth, through this manager, and people kind of get to know you. Because back in the days, there wasn't any Instagram or Facebook. So a record deal was it. There was no, all these different platforms. There was one chart that we knew of. And I got a call from a girl that I was thinking about joining a band with. It was Heavenly, from the Honeys. So this is like way back. And her ex-boyfriend rang me and said that they just lost their singer, which was Joe O'Meara, and they needed a replacement. So would I meet the band? And they were like affiliated with these people that there was a group called the Backstreet Boys somewhere. I've never heard of them.
No, never.
And would I go and meet them? So I went to see them like one day in London, and I had to audition for them literally in the toilet of a hotel, and that is no word of a lie. And then the next day I was flying to Germany, and then about 5 days after that I was in America, and I didn't go home for months.
Oh my word. That's the thing, people don't realize the, I mean, it's obviously it's shocking, the quick turnaround, but how quickly things happen. And also with the performing arts industry, how people know each other, and like, that's why you've got to be really careful you don't like get on the wrong side of the wrong person.
No, she's just always been nice. And it's true what they say, you always meet people twice.
Yes.
And it doesn't hurt to be nice. Excuse me, my puppy's just going mad. Barney! No. Barney, stop.
Is that the dog or the cat?
Yeah, I've got a dog and two cats. There's another lazy thing down here. It's a small world.
Yeah.
It's a really small world.
Talking to, I've chatted to so many people and I've got to get it right. Who was the right, who was it? Rachel Stevens was supposed to be in something. Oh, it was Lolly. It was Anna for Lolly. She was, Rachel Stevens was supposed to be doing the project, and then Rachel Stevens wasn't meant for that, and she went into S Club 7, and then Lolly. Okay. So it is really, but you just, when you're watching it from the outside, like whether you're a kid or a teenager or you know anything, I think that was the other thing. Like, I was saying this to one of my friends earlier, that watching you guys and watching, like, you know, the Backstreet Boys and watching the Spice Girls and watching all these bands, you assume that you all have this luxury lifestyle, driving around in Porsches, flying VIP, and like money just, you know, bathing in it. And people don't realize that it's getting changed in toilets, it's flying from one gig to the next, it's getting ready in the car before you even, you know, make it. Would you agree with that? In the
okay, so, you know, it's not all bad. You get to see the world, you get to meet amazing people, you get to sing, and you get to, I mean, how many 21-year-olds can go and see the world and go and sign a deal in New York? I mean, it's dream come true. Yes, it's really, really, really hard work. There's always sleep deprivation.
Yeah.
And yeah, you might be desperate for a wee and you can't get anywhere, so you might have to just do a wee in a pie glass. because you've got a quick turnaround. It's bonkers hard work, and as long as you're like okay with flying, and I think I could have probably earned more money realistically working in the shoe shop, because you'll pay pocket money and the way the whole industry is. But I'd do it all again tomorrow, especially with the girls. Yeah. But it'd be nice that we could do it with the girls and we're all grown up, because I think we all get on so much better now. We understand each other, and I think there's an honesty with women, you know, once you hit 30 or 40 or whatever, you're not insecure anymore. And you can just be honest.
No.
I think when I hang out with, you know, with the girls, I do last time I saw Becky and Elisa, I saw Becky, was it last year or the year before in London? And we just had such a good time. It was just so lovely.
Yeah. So, yeah. It's like a sisterhood that you never, I think in any performing world, when you're put under certain circumstances, that is not the, it's not reality. It's not the normal, you know, you don't work at Tesco's and then end up getting changed together at the side of the store. It's you do go through the highs and the lows with each other, but and then that builds you. And then, like you say, you, it's something that will connect you forever, which is lovely. Does with being in like the band, I think that's the other thing. Do you think why it's so easy to take advantage of people because we're doing what we love, whether it's singing or dancing or acting? That's how if you get taken advantage of because you are being exploited for what you love.
I mean, look, there is a million people that jump into those shoes. So I think by the time I got to New York and this record contract, bearing in mind, I was dreaming of this record contract. I was writing to Pete Waterman from the age of 11, wow. You know, and the age of 13. I've got a letter from Pete Waterman. I think I was 13, I'd done Opportunity Knocks or Sky Star Search or something like that. And he said, really like the band. This is the young kids band. Come back to me when your voices are mature. Because obviously we were squeaky little kids. And then when you're actually in those studios, you're like, oh my God, you know, this actually happened. Or, you know, there was a singer that I loved growing up called Carlo Paul Santana. And I got his autograph. And he wrote, See You on Top of the Pops. And when you're 13 and someone says that, but there was never any doubt. I was always going to do Top of the Pops. It wasn't like, oh, I'm not going to do it. I'm not, you know, it's just a dream. No, I'm doing it.
Yeah, which is lovely. And it's probably the drive that's kind of carried you forward. I mean, like, what a lot of people don't realise is, yes, you're a singer and you're inside, but you write songs for other people. You say, like, not to put you on the spot, but, like, I know some people, from chatting to different people, some people love being in the recording booth, or do you prefer the actual performing more, or is it hand in hand? Do you like both?
Now that depends who your producer is. Because you can be in the studio with a producer that absolutely gets you straight away and get the best out of you completely, and will just make you feel, and will just bring out the best.
Yeah.
And you think, Christ, I didn't know I could sing like that. But it's because someone has pulled it out of you. And then there's been times where I've been in the studio and one set of producers had never, ever produced a vocal before. And I literally went home and cried. I was like, they're not doing it. You know, it's so bad. And my manager at the time was saying, well, tell them how to do it. And I was like,
that's not your job. No.
No, no. And I probably wasn't brave enough then.
Yeah. I think it's a lot. It's also producer's job is to be honest. Is to say, you can do that again, you can do that better. That pronunciation was off. That was, you know, which is hard to hear sometimes when you're a performer because you want to be the best. But to get the best out of you, it's what they need. Have you got any, like, I know you said you travelled a lot. Have you got any, like, fond memories of, like, a place you went to that was, like, because I've read that you, I mean, you taught, is it Japan, Germany, Malaysia? Is there a place that you went, this is epic?
Japan was really, really bizarre. Not bizarre in a horrible way. It was just like the most
surreal.
I mean, I was born in Coventry, you know. I went to it's not that far from Leicester. I know Leicester really well.
Have they still got the Shires there? The shopping centre? Is it the Shires?
It's in High Cross now. High Cross, darling.
What? Oh, wow. It's been a while.
I know. So Japan was amazing. I mean, Holland, I think each country has different types of fans as well, and they treat you. I had no expectations of, say, Paris. It was amazing. Or I think Japan's always got, Holland was perfect for us. Canada was absolutely fabulous. So, and it also depends how you're treated when you get there. Singapore is probably one of my favourite places in the whole wide world.
Wow. Did you have much time to
In fact, about 7 years ago, I went to Thailand and I was like, oh, I've never been to Thailand before. I'm so excited. And I was going through some stuff and I laughed. It was like, oh, here's me staying in Thailand. I was like, I stayed in Thailand. So you don't really remember. And it, you know, everyone will say it's hard work. It's ridiculous. You don't sleep, but you eat in really nice hotels and the record company taking you out. You know, you do things that you, normal people don't get to do. Right. So don't moan about it. Say, you know, do it all again for free for 3 years and work your ass off again. Yeah, do it.
Yeah, it's weird, isn't it? I suppose it's like, you know, I'm the most stressed. You're up and then you're down and you're on a stage, you come off and it's quiet and, you know, you're back on the on a van or a tour van or on a plane, but then you do it again in a heartbeat, which I suppose is the performer in you. What was it like being with, like, the are they called the Backstreet Boys? Like,
oh, those people that no one's ever heard of.
Amazing.
Well, I hadn't heard of them, to be honest, when I met them. So I met them all kind of on the same day, and I didn't know who they were. And obviously, same with NSYNC, we didn't know who they were. But they weren't really famous. I know that they were like, this band were coming up in Germany, all the rest of it, blah, blah, blah. And then on the way to one of the shows, I sat in one of those people carriers, and the boys were all around me, and then started to sing. That was the first day when I auditioned for the group. And I was absolutely mind blown. It was crazy. It was crazy that they could really, really sing. You like, you get goosebumps. It was amazing.
Yeah, definitely. They, it must have been, oh no idea now, 5 years ago, 6 years ago, there was they did a tour with Busted and McFly. They called it Look McBusted, and they came to Ipswich, which is where I am, and I got a meet and greet I'm not really like fangirl over certain people, but they inspired me so much as like not just with their dancing but their harmonies and things. And I was so not nervous as in like, oh my god, I'm gonna be Backstreet Boys. I was more nervous the fact that they were gonna be like, you know, to put it bluntly, assholes. I was because it would have tainted everything, it had just ruined the experience. But they were lovely. They were really
they really are. I mean, I'll call people out for being like that. They are ridiculously nice and they're very supportive. And Brian at the time, he was kind of in the first album, he was very much, you know, the main singer. And he used to tell me about like singing just behind the beat. And then Kevin would take me to one side and say, look, don't let the industry side of it ruin it for you. You know, it's about the music. So every single one of those boys is really special. I mean, Nick was just a 15-year-old. Yeah. But you know, a nice kid.
He was really ill when I met him. He had his hoodie up and they were talking, and again you get like a nice live conversation going. And I went in and they were talking that Nick wasn't very well, and you could see he wasn't well. And when they came on, you would never have known it if you hadn't have seen them backstage. With you, did you ever have experiences in Solid Harmony where you were, I mean, you must have been like thing you remember where you think, oh, I'm so ill, but you've got to sing.
I want you to want me video. I wanted to go straight to hospital. Yeah, I was so ill. I was so poorly that as soon as they said rap, I burst into tears. It sounded like Right Cry Baby, don't I? But I looked like, oh, I'm so bad. And we had a lovely lady. That was a proper drama queen. A lovely lady from the German record company. She was quite big and quite buxom, and she just like really squeezed me. And we were flying to Holland the next day. And I was like, I've got to go to hospital. Oh, I'm so unwell. And then I rang the hospital, not ever knowing about hospitals. So I was like, how long's the waiting list? And it's still about 4 hours. And I had like a plane to catch in 3 hours. But I was really, and they put me in two tight shoes. I was in this like little dress. And these shoes were like two sizes too tight for me. And then I'm running around because the red dress is like very see-through and I had a thong on. So, yeah, but looking back, I quite like the video. But I was really poorly. And then that night in Holland, we had a show and I couldn't speak. So the idea was then we were going to mime. So we were miming in Sod's Law. The track cut out. So not only did I have no voice,
oh no.
Hey, you know, that's your business.
But I suppose you now look at the video and you think, I was so ill that day and I still look great.
Smoke and mirrors all the time. All the time.
So you did one of my songs, and it didn't one of the actual questions you got, someone wrote in, someone did say, what happened to your solo album? Because I loved your music. And I did love, I put it on your little thingy video that I did. And unless, I don't know if people will, hopefully they'll know the song. The Welcome to My World is one of my favourite songs. I think such a good song. And did you, am I mistaken, did you, you co-wrote as well the Circus track that you released?
Yes, yeah, with a guy called Tim Laws, who wrote Dreams, Gabrielle. Yeah, I wrote it with Tim Laws.
So, to that question, what happened to that, to the album? Someone said, where is the solo album, Melissa?
So, I was living in Germany, and I think it was just after that moment. You know, I said that we'd gone into the studio, and that these producers had never produced a vocal before, and I think that having the security of the girls around me as well was a big thing. Again, probably 24 years old. And I've really just, you know, when golfers choke.
Yeah.
If you heard of that, when they just choke and then you're going to sing and nothing came out. And I remember a producer's wife saying, can you do this little, this vocal lick, which should have been a piece of cake. And all of a sudden, nothing would come out.
Do it. No.
And there were certain things, you know, I wasn't really feeling the whole thing.
Yeah.
So I went back to England to try and sort of lick my wounds and have a bit of time and just wonder what's going on. Then 5 minutes later, my dad got poorly. And then you realise what's important, not making the next record. It's, okay, all right, this is what, you know, you need to step up now and grow up.
Yeah. I think it's... And I think that's really nice that you're honest about it, that, you know, you could just do some, you know, crap story about, oh, you know, it's on its way, as, you know, a lot of people say. I think it feels really real when someone says, this happened and this is why it didn't happen. And like you say, you know, you've been a performer. I think if you'd have then put the album out and you weren't happy with it, you'd always remember that. And you, you know.
I wasn't feeling it at all. I wasn't feeling the whole thing. I think that the bottom line is I didn't have the confidence to do it.
Yeah. Do you miss the obviously I know you say you do it in a heartbeat. Did you kind of enjoy the solo journey as well as the girl band?
No.
No. Honesty, I swear it's...
I've got nothing to hide, seriously. No, I didn't. It just... I'm from a big family. I'm one of seven. And I've always been in bands, and I've always been a team player, and I've always been surrounded by people. And then I was living in Germany, spending a lot of time on my own, and then... No, and I just didn't think I was good enough, actually. And then once you get that in your head...
Yeah.
Then you, I mean, if I looked when I was singing about 2 years ago, if I'd known that I could sing that way back in the girl group or back when I had all those opportunities, if I knew that that was in me and I could make myself sing like that, it would have been a completely different story. But, you know, we live and learn, don't we?
Yeah. Have you ever done any, just like a personal question from me, like, have you, obviously with all your, you know, the training you have had, do you enjoy singing like musical theatre songs?
Do you know what I do?
Yeah.
I do. Do you know that it's a bit of an us and them situation, because growing up, so I was always in like little pop bands. I always felt that stage school kids were probably a little bit uncool, if I may.
Jazz hands.
However, yes, exactly. Yeah. But now, there's so many cool kids coming out of stage school.
Yeah.
I mean, it's ridiculous. And they're so cool, and they're so, I mean, Adele and Amy Winehouse, and you know, these are all people that went to stage school, and look at them. There's nothing jazz hands about them. They're just cool as well.
No, it's always cigarette in hand, Adele, Amy Winehouse. You know, it's a cigarette, not a sparkly cane.
I know. God, cigarettes, bad.
So, we should need, how going from pop star, solo artist, singer into, I read on, again, bits of Wikipedia, bits of interviews that you've done, so I don't know what you should...
It's all true. Wikipedia's all true.
All true. Yeah, you got... And it was an auxiliary nurse into an ambulance technician and into a paramedic, and you also DJ. You've been busy, girl.
Yeah, I'm a bit of a geek.
No, well, I did see, is this true? You got first class honours degree in emergency practice?
Yes.
How many years was that?
How many years?
Yeah.
So we've done our paramedic training. So you kind of did the degree, the top up degree in just over a year.
Yeah.
But like a fool, I decided that I was going to work full time as well as studying. Because at the time I really wanted to go to med school and be a doctor, and I thought, okay, had this like romantic notion is that I was going to be, I suppose, like a bit like Doc Martin, be like a local GP in a seaside village that would get to know families and just take care of everyone but know everyone. And then after I did that, I was then still thinking about med school. And then I worked in a really tough city for 6 months, and it just kicked the stuffing out of me.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. If I'd have been 10 years younger,
yeah,
I probably would have done it.
Really? Like, so it was pretty intense then? Like.
Yeah, I think sort of the idea of starting med school when you're sort of 30 or 35 and then being another student and then, you know, probably then working until you're sort of 45, 50 to get where you want to be, probably just seemed a bit much.
Yeah.
And then I thought, if I do this, I'm never going to write another song. I'm never going to sing another song. That once I make that decision and go for it, that's it.
So is that what you're doing now? Are you a paramedic now? What are you doing now? Like at the, apart from talking to me.
My day job is an emergency care practitioner. So I will be in a GP surgery or an out of hours GP service in another clinic.
Why you've been so busy?
So you're either doing home visits or you're seeing and treating people. At the moment, it's a bit bonkers. You get 10 minutes a patient and it's very full days.
Wow. I can't.
So you'll see them treat or refer someone to hospital or send them to a 2-week wait breast clinic or just review blood tests and things like that. And it's still pretty scary.
Yeah, I was going to say, and it's a different kind of pressure. You've had the pressure of performing to hundreds of thousands of people and knowing that everyone's eyes are on you. And it's a different kind of pressure. If someone's potential life is, you know, in your hands to a point that you've got to make the right decision, but you know, life and death. You've got loads of questions. People said on like, you know, are you going to reform again? Are you going to do any more stuff for Solid Harmony? Is it just a case of if the opportunity arises, you would, you've not written it off?
Yeah. I mean, look, any excuse for me to get together with the girls. And just hang out with them because they're just fabulous, fabulous people. Yeah. Why wouldn't you?
Girls' night out that you just get paid to do.
Exactly. And then we're on stage again. We're all dressing up. We're being glamorous for a night. We get to drink. And I mean, the last time we were in Holland, Yeah, we didn't realise. Lisa, Becky and I were travelling. We just decided we were going to go out drinking for the afternoon, just the three of us. And we didn't realise we were in a quiet train. And we were just the loudest, most obnoxious people. I mean, we were just giggling.
Have you had anybody working with what you're doing now? Like, have you had anyone go, you look really familiar?
Yeah. So I think I was an ambulance technician and we'd gone to Coventry. We'd gone to a young girl that was having an asthma attack and she was really, really quite poorly. But I didn't tell anyone what I used to do because why would you? We nebulized this girl and I could see her looking at me, trying to breathe and like this. And then when she could finally breathe, she went, "You're Melissa from Solid Harmony." And I was like, yeah. And then she could breathe and she was like, "I've got your album in the car. Will you sign it?" And she was really nice. But then my crewmate went, "What on earth are you talking about?"
Oh, my, that's amazing.
Yeah. So it's nice. It's nice, but it was a little bit.
Being like, she's hallucinating. No, it's not me.
Yeah, you're short of oxygen. Don't be silly.
Yeah, that is a story though. If you think, like, I spoke to Daphne and Celeste last week, and they were saying how they were doing a supermarket shop, and some girl approached them and said, "Oh, I really love you. Will you come? I'm gone the way to my birthday party." And they were like, "Yeah, we'll come with you." And they went to this girl's birthday party and randomly sang at this girl's birthday party. And I was like, they're the stories that, you know, on their wedding day or whatever, they'll go, "Do you know, once I had an asthma attack and Melissa from Solid Harmonie brought me back." Do you know what I mean? what I was going to say, I speak to a lot of kids and I teach to a lot of kids. And I know you've been really like open and honest with talking about it, that obviously when you came out of the band, you didn't really know what you were doing and your confidence suffered. And what would you, obviously you've come out the other side of it. What would you say to anyone watching like, that is feeling, especially at the moment?
I mean, I think people, there's a lot of support out there. There's a lot of, it depends what, you know, whether it was just like confidence about performing or just feeling absolutely rubbish in yourself anyway. There's a lot of people out there and there's a lot of support that you just have to go out there, and it can be perfectly normal. I mean, if someone that's been in a pop band can get sort of depressed and, you know, have confidence crisis, then anyone can. And you do get better. There is a way out of it. And you always feel that when you're in it, you're never going to be able to feel better again. You're never going to feel right. You're never going to feel happy again. But you can. But I think just knowing where to get help. Is really important. Yeah, just talking to people, because I don't know anyone that has a life without a problem or a life without, without an issue in it. No one does. Everyone goes through something, don't they?
Yeah. I think life would be, it's awful to say, like, no one likes misery and stuff, but I think I try and say, you know, life would be pretty dull if it was all one level. But at the same time, it's those moments when you do dip that you remember. I've got a couple of questions from some people.
Okay.
Otherwise, I'll get moaned at from people saying, "You didn't ask me a question." So, is there a song that you'd wished you'd had released or that you nearly got that became someone else's?
Hit Me Baby One More Time. What? No, that we really had or wish we had? I wish we had. No, we didn't nearly have it.
Oh, you didn't nearly have it. Oh, but you
No. So I think Britney, strange stories that when NSYNC were formed back, they were kind of like the opposite bands, the Backstreet, like, you know, the rival. Yeah. And then there was a girl group that was formed called Innocence that was supposed to rival us. Yeah. And I think Britney was supposed to be in Innocence before she was a solo artist.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Exclusive.
So yeah, if I wish I had one song, it would have been that one.
Prince Barnett 3 says, "How did you manage..." Well, you've kind of answered this, isn't it? With the choreography, I saw you at Pump Up the 90s, Round Up the 90s. How do you manage the choreography? You kind of said...
I used to struggle with it. But I think now if I make a mistake, or, you know, if I ever used to make a mistake, it's just funny. You know, we're all human. So yeah. I'm not going to beat myself up and punish myself for days because I made a step wrong. If I fuck it up, that's done. Sorry.
No, and I'm not being funny, you sing bloody good. Do you have, so this is from VBX_3_1, do you have any funny stories or a favourite memory of being in Solid Harmonie? I'm sure you've got loads, but you've got a memory that always makes you chuckle. Or a surreal story with another pop star or...
Oh gosh, you should have given me these earlier so I could have thought of the meatiest ones. I mean, look, when you're in a girl group, every day has got funny stories.
Yeah.
Every day has got funny stories.
What was it like on, that's what we said, what was it like on Top of the Pops? Were you on with anyone? Because I suppose when you get there, you don't know who you're going to be on with.
Hinta Hicks was on. Who else was on? I can't really remember. Could have been one of the Boyzone lads.
Oh,
I don't know. I don't know. I can't really remember who was on there, and which is really poor of me. But again, it's that whole like time thing. I know that when we rehearsed, we did it live, and then the camera crew, you know, they started clapping because at the time, not many people used to do it. And you got one chance. You had to go and record, but you did it. And I remember being quite nervous because it was Top of the Pops.
Wow, I'd love to have done that. I mean, I think they should bring it back. I think it was the best.
Oh, no.
It was just the best. And you it was that excitement for knowing what was going to be number one and seeing the performances. And I know at the moment, I don't know if you've seen, Annie Lennox has written that letter that was signed by all them different artists saying streaming needs to change because it's just not fair.
The business now is a whole different beast. It's just, I mean, I wouldn't even know it.
All your CDs, tapes and records and posters and things of like a box or a room with like your stuff?
There's a loft.
With the Christmas decorations.
Yes. I mean, the thing is, you know, you either, it's nice to go up there. I was up there because I needed to go and get something out yesterday. It's nice to have a quick look at things. And when you get time, just go through the photos and crazy times on tour and stuff.
Yeah.
But I can't really live in the past by having it all around all the time, you know?
No. So the last thing, it's been lovely chatting to you, Han. The last thing I always do, if you've seen any other lives, I just do a 10, pick one or the other. What do you prefer, the theatre or drive-in cinema?
Theatre.
80s or the 90s?
90s.
New York or London?
London.
Should have said New York or Coventry. Sunrise or sunset?
Sunrise, every time.
Yeah, your pictures on your Instagram are like amazing. Do you live like in the country, like right in the country?
Yeah.
It is beautiful. Oh, wow. Smash Hits or Top of the Pops?
Top of the Pops.
Yeah. Tape cassette or CD?
CD.
Britney or Christina?
Britney.
Yes.
Baby. Right.
Last three. These are difficult. More Backstreet Boys or NSYNC?
Stop it.
Come on,
honey. God, that's hard. So I knew Backstreet first, and Backstreet Boys, believe it or not, funny story, have all been to my mum's house in Coventry. So on tour in Birmingham, and mum was like, oh, maybe the Backstreet Boys can come. She always have a party. Mum, Backstreet Boys, I'm going to come to our house. And they did. It was a bit bonkers. And my mum introduced everyone. She'd go, everybody, this is Howie. No, it wasn't. She would, my cat introduced him. This is AJ, he's a Backstreet Boy, you know. This is AJ, he's a Backstreet Boy, you know. Everybody, may introduce you to AJ, he's a Backstreet Boy, you know. And at the end, for old AJ, ma'am, thank you so much. But I'm happy. At the end, he'd just been so sweet.
That's amazing. And that's the thing with mums, they're always like, oh, come on here, they don't have a clue. That's amazing. I want to love you, I want you to want me.
Oh, that's like choosing between your children. I want you to want me. Just.
Yeah.
I mean, those two songs were the first songs that we ever recorded with Max Martin. So we'd gone to Sherry On Studios, and that was the first time we'd met them. And they were two songs that we recorded in 2 days. So our first trip to Sweden, and we had these CDs. That was a bloody good start.
Yeah, when you think like how long it takes now for people to do like albums and singles and things like that. So that's I loved To Love Again. I did like that song as well.
To Love Once Again.
And the last one, Cocktails or Cats?
Which one?
Cocktails or Cats. Yeah.
Like cocktails or animal cats?
Yeah, I see your
cats.
To end with, Han, I was going to say, I say this to everybody, what is your number one best bit of advice to anyone watching that you've lived by? Like, could be anything. Your top tip or your best bit of advice to anyone watching.
My dad always used to say, you can never tell one lie. So where you can, don't lie, you know, because you'll have to tell another one.
That's good. You know,
just be grateful. We're here for 5 minutes. We're here for 5 minutes and just enjoy it. And it's not a rehearsal.
Yeah.
If you're in a bad day, it doesn't, you know, hopefully it doesn't last. There's always a way you know, whatever it is, there's always an end to it. So if you've lost somebody, or, you know, your dad's died or something like that, it will always pass, and you will, you know, hopefully always feel better. I think you will. Yeah. It's light.
Well, honestly, Mr. Thank you so much for doing this to me. I really do appreciate it. And I think everyone watching as well, and like I said, people that watch this later, I'll put it onto a YouTube thing. Taking your time to do this, it really helps. And thanks as well for all the work that you're doing in this pandemic. It's amazing.
Thanks.
Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for the chat. It's been really fun.
Oh, good. I'm glad I didn't bore you to death. That's good. No worries. Well, look, take care and stay safe, hon.
Thank you.